Hello, dear children. Welcome you back again for our lesson. We are not afraid to die if we can all be together. As we have seen that this lesson was written by Gordon Cook and Alan East. For the review, in the last class, we have seen that in July 1976, they began the voyage from Plymouth. And they were experiencing very good weather and a cheerful days from England up to Africa. Then, from Cape Town, we see the two sailors joined. What are the names? Larry Vigil and Herb Segler. And on December 25, we have seen that they reached 3,500 kilometers from Cape Town, and that too in the atrocious weather. In between, they celebrated the Christmas. And they hope that definitely the climate will come to a great change by the new year. But it doesn't make any change, but it went for much worse situation. On January 2nd, 1977, they experienced huge waves and they were sailing only with a small jib and was making only 8 knots, the speed. And we see that they saw, the narrator saw a high, very big wave reaching to the top of the mast. The sound and the spray of the wind was highly painful and they were getting prepared to face any situation. That's why they thought of taking precautions, just like the storm jib dropped, double lashed everything, attached lifelines, they put on their life jackets and all. But at the very same time, at 6 o'clock in the same day, we see that Gordon Cook saw a huge wave. It's similar to that of a cloud. He thought that that was a very big cloud because the entire scenario changed to darker. But he later on realized that it was a huge wave which has got double the size of the other waves that they experienced earlier. And we see that this huge wave shook the wave walker and the narrator was thrown overboard. And also we have seen that once the narrator was thrown overboard, he says that as he was just in the water, he felt like he was about to die. And he says that once he felt that he was about to die, there was peace, or he started experiencing peace when he thought that he was about to die. Now for today's portion, take your textbook and just see. Unexpectedly, my head popped out of the water. A few meters away, wave walker was near capsizing, her mast almost horizontal. Then a wave hurled upright, my lifeline jerked taut. I grabbed the guard rails and sailed through the air into the wave walker's main boom. Subsequent waves tossed me round the deck like a rag doll. My left ribs cracked, my mouth filled with blood and broken teeth. Somehow I found the wheel, lined the stern for the next wave and hung on. So what we see here is, here the meanings of the difficult words is said here. Capsizing means to overturn in the water. Then hurled means throw with a great force. Torn means stretched. Okay. His lifeline, or if life jacket, stressed. Okay. Torn. Then boob means the pole that controls the ankle and shape of the sail. Crampled means climb. Close one way. Hatch is door. Okay. So what we see here is, last class we have seen that he was thrown into the sea and he thought that he was about to die. But here we say that suddenly his head popped out of water. Popped out means what? Came out of water. And he saw that the boat had almost overturned. And his life jacket, as we have seen that here, it says that then a wave hurled her upright and my lifeline jerked taut. So at this moment, when the ship was, or the boat was about to sink, there came another wave that hurled it upright, and we see that with the help of the life jacket, he grabbed the guardrails and sailed to the main pole. Okay, somehow he got hold of the side of the ship, and as the other wave came, he was thrown into the deck. Deck here means floor or the open space of the ship or the boat. So he was thrown by the coming of the next wave. You know that it's very huge waves are just attacking this boat. The climate is rough. Already they was very sure. That's one of the reason why once they came to Cape Town, they thought of hiring two experts, two crewmen. Okay. So actually they experienced this. They know that. But they never thought that it was going to be somewhat very dangerous likewise. So he never expected that he'll be thrown out. So once he got an opportunity to come back with the coming of a wave, he was thrown back into the flow. We see that he was he got some injuries. His left ribs were cracked. His mouth was filled with blood. Then some teeth were also broken. And anyhow, he was not caring about all these things. Somehow he wanted to get in the boat. He wanted to make sure the safety of other members, especially his wife is there, his two children are there, and the crewmen just suffering a lot because water is entering inside this boat by the coming of that huge wave which had thrown this narrator into the sea. So definitely he know that something is going to happen. Somehow when he was thrown back into the deck or the floor of the boat, he managed to find the wheel. Wheel here means the steering wheel. And he lined up the stern for the next wave and hung on. So, and somehow he got, you know, that the ship was just, what is that, overturned. So he somehow got it, and he says that he reached the deck. Water everywhere. I could feel that the ship had water below. But I dare not abandon the wheel to investigate. Suddenly, the front hatch was thrown open and Mary appeared. We were sinking, she screamed. The decks are smashed. We were full of water. So already, in these lines, we have seen that water everywhere. This is a famous line from Ancient Mariner. Okay? This line was written in that Ancient Mariner by Coleridge, Samuel Taylor Coleridge. And in that story, we see that it just talks about the life of sailors who was stuck in a sea. They were stuck in the sea. But the thing is that the ship was not flooded with water. Once the ship was stuck in the sea was also lifeless. It was not moving. So what happened? They are feeling thirsty. But they can't drink water from the sea because water, you know that it's salty water, and moreover the water in the sea is now lifeless. Once the sea gets lifeless, what will appear? Snakes or some crawlings, something will appear likewise, you know that. So, and here the same line is repeated here by telling that everywhere there is water. But the meaning is not the same like was said in Ancient Mariner. But here it says that even inside the boat he could see what? Water. Outside the boat there is water. Inside the boat there is water. That's why the narrator says that water everywhere, copying the lines from or just enunciating the lines from the Ancient Mariner by Coleridge. But what he says here is, now the boat was flooded with water. So the deck means the roof or the topmost part of the boat. Inside that there are cabins where children are safe enough, his wife is safe enough. And we see that this deck was full of water. So somehow this is a place where deck is and this is wheel. Okay. So once he happened to thrown into this deck and he got hold of this wheel, he never thought of leaving that one because he doesn't want to get back into the sea. He was holding it. Okay. That's what it says. The narrator knows the boat was flooding with water, but he dare not abandon the wheel. He was holding it tightly to make sure that he is well protected. He doesn't want to get it thrown back into the sea. By the time, what happened? The hatch opened. Hatch means the door. Maybe one door is placed on the deck. Okay, it was opened, and who came out? This his wife Mary came out and informed him that the boat is sinking. They also started knowing that something is happening and the boat is about to sink. So you can just imagine the condition of the people inside the boat. They are definitely sure that their life is going to end this moment. Okay, now next line. Take the wheel, I shouted as I scrambled for the hatch. Larry and Herb were pumping like madmen. Broken timbers hung at crazy angles. The whole starboard side bulged inward. Clothes, crockery, charts, tin, toys, loads about in deep water. So what happens here is, once he got hold of this whale, and once this Mary came and said that we are about to sink, he said, okay, Mary, you just hold on this wheel, or just make sure that the steering is safe and it's on the good direction. So handing over the wheel to Mary, he went inside, somehow crawled towards the hatch, as means to the door. And by the time this crewman, two crewmen, what they were doing? They were pumping the water out like madmen. They were trying their level best to save the ship from sinking. So they are doing their level best. So somehow the narrator just crawled through the door and he went inside. So by the time he could see that the wooden beams had already broken, then the starboard means the right side of the boat, okay? The right side of the boat is said to be the starboard side, okay? The starboard side had bulged inward. Bulged means, that means because of the force of the wave that just made a curve or a bulging towards the boat. You can just imagine how it seems to be like. Okay, it was bulged inward. And if such a wave like what happened earlier, if it comes once again, definitely it will break into pieces and they will sink. So it was now only in a situation like it was bulged inward. And through these open spaces, you see that what is just moving all around, the cloaks, crockeries, charts, tin, toys, everything was moving around in water. That means water entered inside the boat. That's why who came out? Mary came out and informed our narrator, Gordon Cook, that we are about to sink. Okay? Here it seems to be like, here he says that she screamed, the decks are smashed, we were full of water. And he shouted, and he scrambled for the hatch. Somehow he managed to climb towards the door. And we see that Larry and Herb were pumping like madmen. And broken timbers, timbers means the wooden parts of the board, started hanging all over. And the right side of the board or the ship was bulged inward. And also we see that inside the board, what is just moving all around? Clothes, crockery, charts, everything was moving all around. Okay. And now here it says that the next here says that I half swam, half crawled into children's room. Are you all right? I asked. Yes, they answered from an upper bunk. But my head hurts a bit, said Sue, pointing to a big bump above her eyes. I had no time to worry about the bumped head. After finding a hammer, screw and canvas, I struggled back on deck. With the starboard sides bashed open, we were taking water with each wave that broke over us. If I couldn't make some ripple, we would surely sink. Now what happened here? The narrator says that somehow he entered. Here it says that I half swam, half crawled into children's room. That means the boat is now filled with what? Water. Okay. So that's when it says that I half swam and half crawled into children's room. And he inquired the position of children. This is where we see the love of father. And at the very moment, he was ignoring his injuries. Already we have seen that his mouth is full of blood, his ribs cracked, and his head just hit on the deck of the ship and all. But he was not caring about that. He wanted to see whether his children are fine or not. Somehow he entered into children's cabin and they were sitting on the upper bunk. Okay, bunk. Bunk means here it says that they were sitting on the bunk of the room and they were safe there. And he asked how you feel like children. And what the answer they said, here it says that, yes, we are fine. We are all right. But Susanna, you know, Susanna, his daughter, complained about one thing. What is that? Father, see, I have a big bump on my head near to her eye. Okay? She was just showing that to her father. You know how a child just respond to her father, then because of love, much love. And she also says that but it doesn't matter. But she want to say that, father, see here on the right side or the side of my head, there is a huge bump. Okay? Complained about a big bump on her head. But here we see that the narrator didn't pay much attention because his intention was not to concentrate much time spending with children. He only wanted to know whether the children are right or not. They are all right or not. His major concern was to save these children and his family, his crewmen from where? From death. Okay, you can just imagine how the situation will be. Here the sea is very stormy with big waves, heavy waves. The sound of the wind is very painful. And when it just comes over, it attacks. You know the painful, how painful it will be like. And also we see that the narrator who are injured much, he is also experiencing great pain in his life. But he ignores everything. He is only concerning about one thing. What is that? Okay, he wanted to know whether his children are fine, whether his family is fine, because it was their dream. For 16 years, they spent their money, their time, the space for this particular journey. But now, see, it's only they started the journey July, August, September, October, November, December, January. It's going to be 7 months. They planned for 3 year voyage. But coming to the 7th month, they started experiencing great storm. Okay, so here we see that the narrator didn't pay much attention because his major concern was to, or his major interest was to save them from sinking, from death. Then he say that here we see that then the narrator says that after finding a hammer, screw and canvas, I struggled back on the deck with the starboard sides bashed open. We were taking water with each wave that were taking us with each wave that broke us over. If I couldn't make some repair, we would surely sink. Okay, so here we see that after the narrator just somehow gathered some screw, hammer, canvas, and he went back to the deck. Okay, and he wanted to repair the things, especially the starboard side, which was just bulging inward, and he wanted to get it fixed. Otherwise, what will happen? It will again get damaged, and water will enter inside this, and definitely they will sink in the sea. So, with all the things that he could gather, here he says that, what is that? With the starboard side bashed open. Bashed open means strike hard. He just striked hard to get it opened, and he wanted to get it repaired. He wanted to close it. Okay, he wanted to close, make sure that he wanted to make sure that it's waterproof and not to let water enter inside the ship. So the bulged part he wanted to repair. For that he took the screw, hammer, canvas. Canvas is for placing the broken part. By the time what these crewmen were doing, they were just pumping out water. They were just taking water from the ship and they were just throwing out. Okay, like whom? They were just doing like madmen. They were pumping the water very fast. And by the time you see that he was also doing his level best, the narrator found some screws, hammer, canvas. He went back to the deck and he was getting ready to fix the problem. Otherwise, he was pretty sure that they will all sink in the sea. Okay, somehow I managed to stretch canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. Some water continued to stream below, but most of it was now being deflected over the side. More problems arose when our hand pump started to block up with the debris floating around the cabins and the electric pump short circuited. The water level rose threateningly. Back on the deck, I found that our two spare hand pumps had been wrenched overboard, along with the foresteer sail, the jib, the dinghies, and the main anchor. Then I remember we had another electric pump under the chart room floor. I connected to an outpipe and was thankful to find that it worked. So here we have seen that the narrator, he was trying to repair the starboard side, which was letting much water in, and if he could not fix the problem, definitely they will all sink. So what happened? Somehow he managed to stretch canvas and secure waterproof hatch covers across the gaping holes. Now his intention was what? To stretch to take a canvas cloth and to secure the waterproof hatch. Hatch is the door, the upper part of the deck. Okay, near to the deck there is a door. So now he is just trying to close the gaps which already happened there. Okay, in order to avoid water entering inside the boat. Slowly and steadily he just started repairing the works of this boat, which was damaged by the threat or which was damaged by the huge wave. Okay, and now here it says that as he was just covering this canvas cloth to secure the waterproof hatch in order to cover the gaping holes, some water streamed below and some was now deflected over the side. So you can see that some water was still lying on the floor. So he thought of just diverting the flow of the water towards the sides. Okay. And he just worked on the deck in order to avoid this water entering inside the boat. And also we see that as they were just, these two crewmen, Larry and Herb Sigler, was just pumping out water from the boat like madmen, isn't it? As they were doing all these things, we can see that their hand pump was blocked with the debris floating around. Debris here means the things. Already we have seen that when water entered inside the boat, all the things which was kept in the cupboard, everything started floating all over. So because of this, and also the tiny waste particles or tiny things that entered inside the pump and that blocked. Okay, their hand pump was blocked. And also along with this, we see that their electric pump was also what? Short-circuited. Definitely, that created a stop in pumping water. Okay? So, you know that they might have got into trouble. Okay? Then, we see that immediately, this narrator sort of just thinking about the additional pump which was kept, or additional electric pump which was kept in the chart room. Okay, so when this hand pump was blocked and they stopped pumping water, slowly and steadily with the gaps which is already there in the board, water started coming and the water level started rising. Okay, and the narrator found two hand pumps had been removed with the rope, jib and a small board along with the main anchor. Okay, then he thought of it. Here we see that, however, later he found a spare electric pump then connected to drain the water. He found one spare electric pump in the chart room. He connected it to an outpipe and it started working. So they were very happy that they can pump out water. Okay. And what we see there here, the meanings of the things were given here. Foresail, jib, dinghies. Dinghies means the small open boards in which you have seen that the narrator found two hand pumps had been removed. Along with what? Along with the rope, along with the jib and small board. Okay. And the main anchor. Main anchor is something, a weight that is put in the sea in order to give the balance. Okay. And heavy object that is dropped off the side of the ship to keep it in one place without moving. Okay, so here it says that the next paragraph says that the night dragged on with an endless, bitterly cold routine of pumping, steering and working the radio. We were getting no replies to our mayday calls, which was not surprising in this remote corner of the world. Sue's head had swollen alarmingly. She had two enormous black eyes and now she showed as a deep cut on her arm. When I asked why she hasn't made more of her injuries before this, she replied, I didn't want to worry you when you were trying to save us all. So here we see that this particular night, which was the day? Can you just imagine the day? The day is January 2nd. Okay. January 2nd still continues to be like a long day without an end. So that night of January 2nd, this narrator along with the crewmen, they were just tirelessly working out in order to pump water, because already they got two hand pumps blocked. Okay, then they found a spare one from the chart room, and then he connected it, and now they can just pump out water. So here it says that January 2nd night, the narrator as well as the crewmen were all pumping the water out. Okay, and along with that, they were working on the steering wheel also. Okay, and here moreover, we see that they were just talking that here, apart from this, they were trying to get some connection with the radio. Okay, what is here? Because they wanted to connect it with the dry night, dragged on with an endless bitterly cold routine of pumping. Bitterly means, you know, that in the midst of the ocean, how the climate will be. They were very bitterly cold, and they were pumping water, steering and working the radio. They wanted to get signal. They wanted to give signal telling that they were in danger. They were not to call for help. So nothing is working here. Okay, somehow they need to get signal. So here it says that they were waiting for the replies that they already sent through the radio. There also nothing happens. What was the reason? Now they understood one thing, that they were in a place where they cannot get any signals. Okay, which was not surprising in the remote corner of the world. We were getting no replies to our mayday calls. What is mayday calls? Mayday calls is emergency call or SOS calls. SOS calls means save us all. Okay, this SOS message, you know that SOS message or SOS is made when someone is in danger. So here also these people was in danger. So at that time they were just trying to connect the signals with the radio, but no replies they are not getting from anywhere, and they say that nothing will happen because they are in one of the remote corners of the earth. Okay, and now that's maybe one of the reasons that they are not getting the replies to the signal sent over through the radio. Okay, now what happened? Another thing that happened there is Sue's concern. What is that? Now father found that Sue is having, or Susan now was now seamed with what? Swollen head. What is that? Sue's head was now more swollen, and she had two black eyes with deep cut in her hand. See the condition of our Susan now. She is only 7 years of age, isn't it? This girl, and she was sitting there with bulging eyes and with a deep cut on her arm. But she didn't complain about these injuries. She only said about one thing. Do you remember that she complained only that I have got a bump in my head. The only bump in my head, she said when her father visited her in children's cabin. Now father saw that this Susan now with swollen eyes, then with what, a bump on her head, and also about what, a deep cut on her arm. Immediately father asked, why can't you tell me all these things? You didn't set me about this thing. Then what she said? Here we see that she said that, okay, she said that she didn't want to worry him as he was trying to save their life. See the mentality of this little girl. Isn't it? She doesn't want to worry, or she doesn't want to bother others with her cuts. She doesn't want others to worry about the pain that she is experiencing. Even though she is a very small girl, she understood one thing, that her father, that her daddy is tirelessly working in order to save their life. And this little girl understood that they are in danger. So, this pain, this cut doesn't matter as long as her father is working without a rest for the night, for the entire day. You know that January 2nd was a great hazardous tormented day for this family. Even in this night time, these people were tirelessly working. What is that? They are just pumping water when they just got out of this two hand pumps in a damaged position. Then again they went out to see whether a spare one is there. Isn't it? They got one from the chart room. They took it, connected. Then they started pumping water. Isn't it? So all night these people were doing. And you know that the damage that happened to the boat. Okay? So this time Susanna doesn't want to worry her father. The next paragraph says so. By morning on January 3, the pumps had the water level sufficiently under control for us to take 2 hours rest in rotation. But we still had a tremendous leak somewhere below the water line. And on checking, I found that nearly all the boat's main reef frames were smashed down to the keel. In fact, there was nothing holding up a whole section of the starboard hull except a few cupboard partitions. So here, now, January 2nd was a great day for them. It's a sleepless night. This father, crewman, all worked. Now, the dawn of January 3. On this fine morning, here we see that they managed to bring the boat under control. How? By pumping water. Because last night they were not sleeping. They were working very hard in order to pump out what? Water. And now, for the time being, they thought of taking rest in rotation for 2 hours. That means when one person is working, two persons are working, one will take rest. Then another one. Just like what? In rotation, they thought of taking some rest. Because all this day and night of January 2nd, three of these people were tirelessly working out. Okay? Now, after working so much, now they come to know that there is a tremendous leak somewhere below the water line that should be found. Otherwise, again, they will go under, what is it? Go without a control of water just rising inside this boat. Okay? So here we see that this person, the water level which was under control by the morning of 3, all of them took 2 hours rest in rotation. Okay, that means half an hour one will take, then half an hour other will take, then half an hour other will take. Likewise, they thought of taking rest, but still there was some leak somewhere below the water line. They wanted to find it out. Okay, now they found that the boat rib, that the wooden frame structure was badly broken till the bottom. The keel is the lower part of the boat. Okay, and here there is a wooden frame, and the wooden frame down to the keel, the bottom of the ship, there is something has broken. There is some damage happened to the bottom of the ship. Otherwise, if that was not mended, definitely water again will come up and they will just put themselves into end. So what is that here? And also they have seen that along with the boat rib, the structure was badly broken till the base of the ship, and the whole section of the starboard held together with a few cupboard partition. Already we have seen that the right side of the boat is said to be the starboard side, and that side was held together with what? With few cupboard partitions. So maybe through that way, or maybe through the keel, the bottom of the boat, some gaps may be there. Water, some leaking is happening all over there. They thought of just finding out. We have next paragraph. We have survived for 15 hours since the wave hit, but we work a wooden hull together long enough for us to reach Australia. I checked our charts and calculated that there were two small islands a few hundred kilometers to the east. One of them, Isle Amsterdam, was a French scientific base. Our only hope was to reach this pinprints in the vast ocean, but unless the wind and the sea abated so we could hoist sail, our chances would be slim indeed. The great wave had put our auxiliary engine out of action. Now we have seen that the narrator was telling that, what is that? Now it's going to be 15 hours since they were attacked by what? Attacked by the waves. For 15 hours, this is January 3. Okay. It's January 3. The date is January 3. And now here it says that they are reminding us, telling that it's going to be 15 hours since they were attacked by the great wave. You remember that the great particular wave that thrown the narrator from the boat to the sea, isn't it? The next wave just put him back to the sea. And now they understood one thing. If they are not maintaining their boat correctly within the limited time, they couldn't even reach to the nearest island. And also one thing they understood, that it was very difficult in this condition to reach Australia. Australia is the destination. Okay, from Europe they thought of making a duplicate voyage, just like which was did by Captain Cook. Okay, and their destination is Australia. Okay, and now they understood one thing, that in this damaged condition of the boat, it is impossible to continue the 3-year planned voyage to reach the destination. Where is the destination? It's Australia. Okay, now what happened? The narrator is looking for some places where they can just go and save their life. The narrator checked the charts. Okay, he went to the chart room. He started checking the chart. Okay, charts, and calculated there were two small islands a few kilometers to the east. And one of them was Isle Amsterdam. Okay, now he checked the charts and calculated that Isle Amsterdam, a French scientific base, was their only hope. If they plan to reach that Isle Amsterdam within the limited or calculated time, they can save their life. Anyhow, it's impossible to reach to their destination. Okay, now their only hope was to search and reach the island. Which island? Isle Amsterdam. Okay, and now again it says that now this is possible, even though they wanted to reach there safely. What should support them? Even the climate as well as the environment should support them. If there is a great wind, or here we see that some huge wave likewise, which happened earlier, will attack this boat once again, it's impossible for them to reach there. So anyhow, the possibility to reach the island depends upon what? Depends upon the wind as well as the sea. Okay, heavy storm can even damage, because almost all parts of the starboard side is bulged inward, and also it was just together mixed up with the partition, the cupboard partitions, and even the keel, the bottom part of the boat, there was also one leaking. And talking about the deck, somehow they managed to cover up with the canvas, clothes and all. So here it says that it depends our landing in or the reaching towards this Isle Amsterdam depends majorly upon the possibility of wind as well as the sea. Otherwise, it's impossible for them to travel in this damaged boat. Okay, so, and here it says that if the sea and the wind is against them, there is less chances for them to reach this island. Okay, and here we see that already the wave has destroyed the ship's auxiliary engine. Auxiliary means supporting engine. So with only one engine, they are just managing. That's why when he was just trying to reach to the children's cabin, he was just asking others to be with. Okay, and now here the secondary engine of the warship has already got out of control because of the wind. So their hope is only one place, that is Isle Amsterdam, which is very near to this boat now. Okay, and that too the east side of this sea. Okay, somehow they wanted to reach there within the limited time in order to see their life safe and secure. Okay, I think we can stop here. And here we see that somehow this narrator is hopefully waiting a few kilometers to the east to reach Isle Amsterdam. Okay, let's stop. Okay, thank you all. Have a great day. God bless.